Right. So welcome to the session. So as actually mentioned by the host and other people, we are now going to see how to build a OKR driven product roadmap, right? Based on my experience, of course. This is a quick introduction about myself. Respecting your years of experience, I'm not going to go through the slide word by word. Quickly, you can take a look into the slide. And this is my Agile Mentorship Program framework. And these are all the clients with whom I had worked in the past. Okay, so just to give a quick introduction about myself. Okay, so before I actually get into the actually the flow of the session, right, I just wanted to begin the session by this particular slide so as to set the context or the tone of the session. For example, right, you might have heard these kind of conversations, right, saying that your product owner or your business sponsor or your product manager or someone from the client side, head of the product management group, some kind of conversations that typically happen saying that we have an upcoming release and we need almost most of the features to be pushed into the production. Of course, we have some kind of a prioritization techniques to do all those things. So the second aspect to the question is, sometimes I have seen based upon my experience, there is always a disconnect between what actually people try to build on the ground versus what is the vision of the product, or rather vision of the portfolio, or rather the vision of the program. So in some places, I will be slightly using interchangeable the words like product and program because the context of the ecosystem matters a lot. But then the essence of the conversation is sometimes we actually keep hearing these kind of conversations. Team members used to talk, hey, we have only limited capacity, right? That too, the Diwali season going to come in place next month. I'm not sure how will we do a real-time capacity planning with less people on the ground and what kind of features we need to prioritize, blah, blah, blah. So some kind of conversations happen. That is actually one part, one of the aspect or dimension to the problem statement. The second aspect is how are we really going to align? What are we trying to build to the overall product vision or the portfolio vision? So these kind of conversations typically happen. And in this session, I'm going to share my experience on it. Okay, this is the context of the session. Okay, so before I get into the slides and other materials, right, I just want to convey a point that some of the materials which I'm going to use in the slides, I have actually taken from a reliable source by the name Yogesh Ratnaparki. He is like a product management leader at Microsoft. Of course, I have combined some of the pieces of that information with my experience, reference from multiple white papers, and my experience in terms of coaching the product owners and the product managers. So one point what I like to say is product owner is more of a tactical role, whereas a product manager is more of a strategic role, right? Because a product owner typically owns the product backlog, whereas a product manager typically owns the entire product roadmap itself. Of course, in some companies, based on the ecosystem or the context, both the roles will be played by a same person also. But then we still need to be cognizant about what is the difference between a product owner and a product manager, right? From that perspective. Okay. So generally, we actually, when you get into the product management arena, right? So some of the typical parameters which we need to keep in mind is basically it is focusing on creating a value-centric delivery model. We need to have a shared alignment. And we need to be basically in an agile driven engagement, right? The focus is more on enabling the team and empowering the team. So these are all typical characteristic features which you generally start imbibing from the four lines of Agile Manifesto, the 12 principles of Agile, irrespective of the framework used, whether you use a Scrum or Kanban or Less or DAD, Spotify, Nexus, whatever be the framework, the underlying principles behind practices are of a paramount importance. So from that perspective, focus is so some people come to me and then ask, right? Okay, how do you define business value? We actually understand the English meaning of the word of value, but then what could be the business value? So my experience to it is business value is the value as perceived by the business. So ideally speaking, this question you need to ask to the head of the product management group or someone who is funding that particular initiative. Okay, how are you actually, you know, interpret the contextual meaning of the word value? Me as an enterprise agile coach, I can only play the role of an improvement enabler in that journey. I'm not the right guy to define value there. Of course, I can give you some quantitative techniques like WSJF, waiter shortest job first, or like we know, some kind of a Kano model, Moscow model. All those things are actually there to prioritize it. So before we get into the crux of the slides, I am just requesting the audience or the participants to keep these three pointers in the mind, okay? And at the relevant touch points, we will come back to it. Okay, now, typically, right, before we get into your product roadmap, no, we actually need to be clear on, at least on a high level, right? What is the day, like, no, in terms of the milestone, in terms of the release goals, what are we trying to do and how are we going to align our product features, right? Because I'm sure many of you will be using some tools like Jira or Rally. Some people will be using tools like ServiceNow. Whatever be the ALM tool, whatever be the tool, typically we have something like a Epic, something like features, something like a user story task and a subtask. So that vertical alignment is of a paramount importance. And here we are going to focus on, okay, how do I create a product roadmap which is aligned to the goal? So this particular OKR is the answer to that particular question. Okay, so we'll just keep going through the slides. Okay, so let us take a simple example, right? Let us take a simple example that we are going to look into something called a classic shopping cart, right? Like it could be a Flipkart or it could be Amazon. Yes, simple portal. What do we try to do there? We just register or you have a OTP, then you log into the portal, then you have a user interface and a user experience over there. Then you select the product, you apply a search criteria, put a filter, and then you select a product, you actually add it to the cart, and then you proceed to check out, some kind of a usual flow, right? Which we all know. Now, in this particular scenario, probably we will try to understand how I can bring in building a product roadmap based on the OKR. Okay. So for people who are new to the term, OKR stands for objective and key results. And we have something called a KRA and we have something called a KPI. KRA stands for a key result areas followed by the KPI, which we all know as a key performance indicators, right? So we are now going to take a simple example here. So in this particular example, we are now going to see, okay, now I have understood that I need to do a prioritization technique. Probably, what is the goal? So one need to be very clear on the goal. See, now here the point is, I'm not directly jumping from the vision to the features. I'm now trying to orchestrate the building block of my product roadmap itself so that the goal is factored in all my decision making process, right? So here, let us take a simple goal, probably increase the checkout rate. Now, if this is the goal which I need to accomplish as a part of this particular website portal, or it could be an app which you can could just go to Play Store and then download it. If this is the goal, probably what are the features that I need to build so that I'm actually meeting the goal, right? So if you look into my YouTube channel, I have created a video called GQM, Goal, Question, Metrics. So some people have some doubt, okay, if this is the goal, what could be the metrics? So that's why we are actually introducing an intermediate layer called a question, which will be connecting the goal to the metrics, okay? So just to keep the ball rolling, If you have clarity on the goal, probably you can now define the features. Okay, these are all the features which I'm going to do so that based on my envisaged thinking, if I implement these features, my customer experience is going to enhance, right? Because if you have a payment option, more payment option, you are actually factoring more variability. So you are actually expanding your customer base or your target group. So one need to be very clear on the user persona. Only then we can do all these things. Then probably from a technical point of view, if I actually upgrade to a robust API call, then probably the functionality or even from a non-functional requirement, like possibly I can take care of those things. So starting with goal until we have clarity on the features. Now, probably, okay. So first we will see a bit on the theory, and then we will toggle the gear to the practical aspect of it. Now, when it comes to theory, right? Theory says this, you need to be clear on the goal, try to get an alignment, then you start creating a rank order. Okay, probably, let's take you are having a waiter shortest job first, whatever comes from the safe world, right? Let's be clear on the cost of delay, then you divide it by your job size or job duration. And for cost of delay, you take your business value, your time criticality, and then your risk reduction or opportunity enablement, you factor it and then do it. But then I generally tell people, WSJF is a very good place to begin the conversation, not to end the conversation. Why? Because any technique, any model will have its own limitations and constraints. No model will give you 100% credibility. Every model operates within a certain context boundary. So we need to understand that. Okay, now from a theoretical point of view, we need to follow this process. Now, what are all the challenges here? No, probably I cannot see the chat currently, but if you people have some thoughts on what are all the challenges, go ahead and then put it in the chat. I'll just take a 3 to 5 seconds pause. Okay, I'll just continue with the flow. Okay, now the theoretical point of view is that, okay, you define a goal, try to get an alignment with the larger forum, then you have some prioritization technique, and then you build a roadmap. Now, life looks very simple, seen from a theoretical concept. What is the challenge here? In reality, this is a good place to begin the journey, but not to end the journey. Why? Because sometimes goals are very fuzzier. Means what? You cannot say with a 100% in a very tangible manner, because it involves an element of a subjectivity, right? Whenever you are building an application which is going to interact with a heterogeneous customer base, you always have an element of a subjectivity. And these features are more like a hypothesis, right? That is why in one of my projects, we have measured something called the feature usage index. Means once this application goes to the production, based on the hit ratio, based on the traffic, based on the volumetric analysis, how far this feature has been used by the real-time end users. Because in a product, not all features are equally used, right? Even if you take your own mobile, you are not going to use all the features in the mobile at an equal distribution, right? So these are all, so that is the difference between some theoretical part and the ground level reality, right? So features are more like a hypothesis, and the impact of the feature, it is very difficult to quantify it, right? So these are all the ground level challenges. Now, to overcome these challenges, we are now saying, okay, guys, why don't you try an OKR-driven prioritization technique, which means when you are trying to build your roadmap for the product itself, when you are trying to create a flow orchestration itself, I am trying to keep my OKR in the mind. Okay, let us take some real-time examples of OKR, right? For example, let's say a person is defining a goal. I need to lead a healthy life. Okay, I'm just giving an example, okay? And then we will go to this. Let's say the goal or the objective is that particular person is writing a goal statement. I need to lead a healthy life going forward. Now, does this statement alone is going to, you know, cover all the colors of the rainbow? Mostly no. Because healthy sometimes comes with an element of a subjectivity. What is healthy for me could be slightly different from some other person. So that's where KRAs and KPIs matter a lot. Healthy in terms of what? Either it is your body mass index, or your flexibility, or your cardio fitness, or what do you mean by healthy, right? For a simple example, okay, keep aside the agile world and all those product and all. Even from a real-time perspective, you cannot have that entire encapsulation only with the goal. So we need to define the attributes or parameters of the goal. That's why we are now trying to look into this. If the objective is to increase the checkout rate, probably what will be my key result areas, right? See, for example, right, many of you would have went through some online portal and you will be going through till the time the payment comes. Then something comes to your mind, you will not do the payment. And sometimes you will think that, hey, what is this? There are 10 screens for me to go to the payment. By the time you are going through the fifth screen, you will lose interest, right? So these are all some of the human psychological factors. That is why we always tell design thinking is of a paramount importance. See, irrespective of the technology, ultimately the products are consumed by the end users who are people. So we need to keep people in the mind, right? So in terms of the key result, probably reducing the click to checkout or complete the transaction, or probably reduce the drop off at the payment screen. Then mostly you will need to improve the customer satisfaction. Okay, now, before I get into the next slide, I just want to say some basic concepts in Agile, because those concepts will help you to understand things better. Generally, what happens, right, when you talk about outcomes, they are fundamentally two outcomes, right? One is called the Agile outcome. Second is called the business outcome. Agile outcome could be improvement in predictability, improvement in productivity or throughput, or rather reduction in cycle time, lead time, improvement in flow efficiency, improvement in quality. These are all Agile outcomes. When you talk about business outcomes, improvement in a CSAT score, your customer satisfaction score, improvement in the NPS value, revenue margin improvement in the product brand index, these things could be business outcome. Now, based upon my experience, right, most of the time you will be working closer to the development value stream, not really closer to the operational value stream. And these business outcomes will be aligned to the operational value stream, also called as a customer value stream. But most of the times you will be working within your context of a development value stream, also called as a product value stream. So my suggestion to the audience is, whenever going forward, when someone says outcome, you ask them back, which outcome? Are you talking about Agile outcome, or you are talking about business outcome? Because Agile is only a means to get that business outcome. Even this OKR-driven prioritization is only a means to that particular end result, okay? So with this thought process, let us now go to the next slide. So can we take some 10 seconds to look into this slide, and then I will continue. Okay, till now, are you people okay with the flow of the session? If you are okay, can you just give me a thumbs up as a feedback, just to know the pulse of the audience? Okay. All right. Okay. So, okay. Now here, okay. Now what are we trying to do? I am trying to suffuse my OKR into my product lifecycle journey, right? So I start with a strategy. Okay. Ideally speaking, see, what are we trying to do? We are still trying to resonate with the Agile onion planning model, right? You have your day-wise planning, you have your iteration-wise level planning, then you have your release goal, then probably your road mapping, then your product strategy, vision, a kind of an agile onion planning model. Now the point here is, when it comes to pure play product lifecycle, I have a strategy, I have a, like, I need to create a backlog, then I need to prioritize it, then I need to plan it, build it, and then launch it. So the strategy part is implicitly taken care by the OKR. Okay, now we'll just start to look into, okay. Now, when I'm going to build my backlog, now the backlog looks like this. See, I'm not creating features over there. I'm not at all talking about the epics now. Okay, epics will come later. I'm focusing on the goal. Okay, what is the goal? So goal is something which we have covered here, right? Increase the checkout rate. Okay, this is our objective. Now, when I'm creating a backlog, I'm defining the objective, then I'm defining the key results, and then creating features which is going to support that particular key result. Okay, now the moment we take this approach, you no need to justify anyone, because that approach itself is going to justify the people. That is the difference between building a product and then trying to understand the goal and then mapping all your activities resonating with the goal. Because if you have a very good knowledge on this product ownership, product management, design thinking, user persona, what is that you will do is, you will not build a product and then find out the market. First, you will understand the market rhythm, then you will build a product. Because sometimes some companies fail because they are building a product without even understanding the market need. Okay, so I generally tell in my YouTube channel and in my mentoring sessions and all, prepare the soil first, then you sow the seed. Without preparing the soil, if you are trying to sow the seed, you are wasting a seed, right? So the point is, understand the market rhythm, understand where the needle is moving towards, then you build your product. Okay, that is the core concept of a business agility also, adaptability to the market needle, right? So here I define my objective, then I tell, okay, for me to reach this goal, I need these three key result areas. And now for me to achieve this particular result area, this is the bundle of the feature. So in this manner, we are trying to position it. Okay. So here you can take some your backlog prioritization technique. You can actually look into your telemetrics or your kind of a metrics and take some data-driven decision. And then you can also think about what is that 20% of a feature in this product is going to give me 80% of a return on investment or the market share. Of course, you can make this some of the techniques of like a wireframe diagram, prototyping, all those things which you can do in your design sprint, right? Design sprint or iteration, which will typically come before the actual development and your testing activities, right? So these are all some of the concepts. Now, with this understanding on this slide, you have clarity on the objective, you have clarity on the key result, then you have clarity on the features. Now you jump on to your actual backlog refinement. I have seen many people jump on to backlog refinement without understanding the vision, without understanding the goal, without having clarity on the strategic themes. Those concepts are covered at a portfolio level in SAFE anyway, but I'm just trying to tell. So here, if you see, yes, my epic will be now mapped to this particular goal, improve checkout rate. And for me to achieve this goal, I need to have a feature A, feature B, feature C. Then I need to have a user story, right? This is how one sample example in terms of how you can build a product roadmap, keeping in consideration the importance of OKR. Now you have some tools like, okay, the tools part I'm going to cover anyway, but you have some tools like AHA and you have some tools. See, tools are only enablers, okay? By the way, tools are not going to do any kind of a magic by themselves. But then you need to be very clear on the process guidelines before you bring in your tool, okay? If not, you are adding a complexity to the already existing equation, I would say. Okay, now once you do all these things, now comes the point is, okay, now I have understood the goal. I have some clarity on the key result areas. Now what you do, you create your quarterly goals, right? Your Q1, Q2. See, whether you use a framework called SAFE or not, you still need to do a bigger container planning, program increment planning, or whatever. Now they have changed the name, but the earlier versions of SAFE used to have a word called a program increment. Program increment planning doesn't mean that it is only binded to SAFE. We need to start looking into the principles behind the practice. All that it means is I need a bigger container planning across multiple teams. If I have 5 teams and if I need to plan for a work for 8 to 12 weeks, I still need a bigger horizon planning. That bigger horizon planning is called as program increment planning in SAFE. That actually doesn't mean that we need to go towards PI planning only when I implement SAFE. Of course, you also need to factor the context. You also need to factor your Shuhari journey, because whatever I am saying for a restate team is not going to make relevance to your Shu state and Ha state team, right? So look into your Shuhari journey, whatever makes utmost relevance at that time, go ahead and then implement it. Right now, here, if you see, I am mapping my I am mapping my effort against the key results. So this pie chart is a simple example. Of course, we have something called the business value points also, which we try to use in some engagements. It is called as a BVP. We still assign business value points. And then I used to draw a chart. Okay, for me to achieve this much of business value points, what is the feature point number? Because at an engagement level, program level, I cannot live with a story point concept. I still need a bigger connotation, the scale of reference. So we go for a feature point. So the one way which I justify my management and client is I create a graph saying that for these many feature points which we have invested, this is the business value point what we have, what is that we have, no, obtained in that particular quarter, Q1, Q2, Q3. And then you can map to this Q1, Q2, Q3 to your program increments like PI1, PI2, PI3, and then take that particular data and then repurpose it for your QBR meetings also, your quarterly business review meetings. So these are all some of the concepts which we need to keep in mind in terms of planning it, right? Okay. So here, okay, now what are all the different ways by which we can access, okay, some kind of a leveraging touch points, right? For example, if you have understood the former, all these previous slides, right? This particular slide is just trying to, paraphrase that particular understanding, okay? So just to cut a long story short, let's be clear on the goal or the objective. And then let's be clear on the KRAs. And the moment if you are able to quantify it, now you start defining your KPIs. And then you can create a release calendar in the place now. Also have clarity on the release goal. And then you can try to quantify or size your effort against the direction towards the goal. So these are all some of the basic things. Okay, one second. I'm just trying to understand. Okay. Okay, so sometimes what we can see, one more important point is whenever people hear the word retrospective, right, they generally try to only think at a team level or rather at a iteration level retrospective. Need not be. It could be a sprint level retrospective, or it could be a program increment level retrospective, or it could be a release level retrospective. So whenever you are going for a release level retrospectives, these kind of a key result area accomplishment, you can actually project it to the leadership team. Because see, fundamentally, let's try to understand. Leadership is not interested in your Jira dashboards. Leadership is not interested in your velocity. And they are not interested towards your burn up or a burn down chart. All that they are interested is by improving my predictability, by improving my productivity, by compressing my lead time and this cycle time, what is the revenue margin that I gained per quarter? What is the better in, okay, what is that delta improvement in the go-to-market strategy? So unless and until we start connecting our agile outcomes to the business outcomes, it is not going to really serve the purpose when you talk to a person at a VP level, SVP level, right? They are not going to look into your velocity or burn down chart, what you actually pulled from the Jira. So from that larger perspective, these kind of things you can keep in mind, okay? Because based on the target audience only, we need to start using our nomenclature and the vocabulary, right? From that perspective. Okay, so what are the common pitfalls, right? What are the common pitfalls I have seen whenever you start doing OKRs is people will strive for perfection. If you are always aiming to do things perfectly, you will not even begin the journey. So that point we need to keep in mind. And sometimes when this OKR-based thing picks up the momentum, over a period of time, people tend to lose that particular enthusiasm and they will not come back to the table or the whiteboard and start reporting back on the progress. Okay. And sometimes I have seen it is not that only always we need to take a top-down approach. Sometimes we also need to go by a bottom-up approach. Let me tell a simple example. When I was beginning to implement SAFe, in some of the engagements, whenever I was trying to write a program increment objective, PI objective, as per books, by and large, you have your PI objectives, and then your PI objective can be sliced into multiple team level objective. This is perfectly fine. But in a real time, in a ground level, it is not only unidirectional, it is bidirectional. Teams also need to be clear on the quarterly goals, and you roll up all your team level quarterly goals, synthesize it at a program level, then you can create a PI objective. So the flow is actually bidirectional. So those things also we may need to keep in mind, right? So don't always look for a top-down approach. Don't always look for a bottom-up approach. It could be a sandwich approach to taking the best out of both the worlds. Because many of the engagements currently in IT industry are working in a hybrid model, right? You still have a plan-driven approach at an engagement level, but within that particular boundary of the engagement, you try to operate your releases iteratively, incrementally, factoring the feedback loop, whether you use a Scrum or a Kanban as a framework. So those concepts also need to be kept in mind. Okay, now some people may ask, what are the tools in the market to build product roadmaps? These are all the tools. And if you take me, of course, I have used Trello, Asana, Jira, as obvious, Rally and all. Typically, from a product management building dedicated tools, I have worked on these three tools. Of course, the license was given by the client. Okay. So probably you can, when I share this particular PPT, you can take a look into these tool names and then probably do a Google search and then learn more, something like that. Okay. I'm just giving some kind of a tips or a pointers here. Okay, so before, so can we take a pause here? Can we handle some of the questions? And then we can jump on to my closing slides on my program. How is that? I just want to check with
Balaji. Sorry for interruption, Balaji. So we have a Q&A session at the end of this one. So you have 10 more minutes to wrap it up.
Sure, okay. Then let me go through, let me just complete it. Okay, so... So in this short session, I can just only introduce you to some of the concepts. I think I have done that part to some extent. And for people who wanted to know about my mentorship program, I have a mentorship program across multiple levels, right from a Scrum Master to an executive coach. Of course, we have different levels in our lesson plan for different target audience, because as obvious, one size fit is not going to work out, right? So I have L1, L2, L3, and I have different lesson plans for a different target audience. And by and large, factoring the feedback from the people also, I actually keep on improving this particular lesson plan also, the contents of the lesson plan, okay? So these are all some of the testimonials with the people who have already got benefited like out of my lesson plan. I typically begin this journey in March 2021. It's been 2.5 years. In this 2.5 years, a lot of refinements have also happened in a continuous manner. So these are all some of the testimonials from the people who have already completed the mentorship program. I have somewhere close to 120 people in my mentorship program currently. And these are all some of the quick feedback from the people who have completed it and got multiple offer letters. See, getting an offer letter is only a byproduct, I would say. What is more important is actually building up the real-time capabilities for you to deliver sustained value. Because what's the point in getting an offer letter and you when someone joins the company and then struggles to do the job, it actually doesn't make relevance there, right? So building real-time capabilities are the target. Offer letter, clearing an interview, growing up in the career, improving the salary designation, all these are byproduct in that journey. Okay, I think I'm pretty much done with the slides. If you are okay, I can share my LinkedIn URL in the chat, right? So that people can connect with me. How is that?
I'll share, Balaji. No, not a worry. So sure. We can go ahead for the question and answers.
Yes, sure. We can go ahead.
Okay.
Balaji, sorry to interrupt. While we go for Q&A, right? If you still have any thoughts, we are good to go ahead, where you can take another 5 to 10 minutes if you have any thoughts, because we got very good response from participants. So based on that, you know.
Unless
you are done with your thoughts.
Yeah, so let me share some more points which actually comes to my mind. See, based upon my experience, right, I have seen that whenever people hear the word coaching agile teams, right, generally people think it is coaching only the team members of the team. But then from my perspective, product owners also need to be coached. Product managers also need to be coached. And whenever I use the word coached, you know, doesn't mean that only doing coaching. Like it could be a combination of training, consulting, teaching, facilitating, mentoring them based upon the dynamics of the particular engagement, based upon the timeline available. It is like shifting the gears of the car. We cannot always ride the car on a single gear. So from my experience, one of the challenge for most of them, right? Typically people who are actually working in a client and a vendor kind of a setup, people who are working in a service-based IT industry kind of a setup, this product owner will be from the client side. Okay. I'm actually telling the ground level reality. This product owner will be from the client side. And if the product owner is exhibiting a kind of a lethargic mentality, common sense tells that you cannot escalate against your client because this product owner is from the client side. So in those kind of challenging situations, you need to know how to maneuver through the road, because you cannot say there is a traffic jam, I cannot travel, right? You need to know avenues of possibilities, how to maneuver through the road and then get to the destination. So in such cases, we also need to start speaking the language or vocabulary of the business guys. If you go to a business sponsor and if you tell them a spike, something called an enabler, something called architecture runway, something called microservices, Docker, Kubernetes, those guys are not interested in all these things. But if you go to them and then talk feature usage index, something called OKR, something called improving the product brand index, something called improving the go-to-market strategy. So one of the important takeaway could be use the vocabulary nomenclature accordingly based on the target group. And some people will tell me, you see Balaji, what you tell makes sense, but please don't use jargons. But my say is it is a jargon only when you say it without understanding, right? Nothing is a jargon if you really understood the context, the concept, and the purpose. And if you use a word, no word is a jargon. It is a jargon only when you just take something from the book, something from chat GPT, something from the Google, and then when you say. But if you really understood the entirety, nothing is a jargon. So feel free to use the right word. Because in the place of architecture runway, you still need to use architecture runway only. You cannot use some other word to replace it, right? So these things also we may need to keep in mind. So these are all some of the points what I thought to tell to the people, so that because some people may have that inhibition, like if I start using these words, okay, people may give a comment that I'm using jargon. As long as you are able to understand what you say and makes relevance to the context, no, nothing is a jargon. Okay. And one more thing. I was just thinking to share some of my website details, and for people who wanted to connect with me, you can actually be part of these social media platforms. I'm just putting it in the chat. So whosoever wanted to connect with me, you can be part of this. Like in the meantime, we can take the question and answer so that it has a coverage. Is that okay?
Yeah, sure, Balaji. Yes, you
That's
can
go sure. ahead. Okay, any questions? Let's try to discuss it here. hopefully, I should be able to answer all your questions.
Anyone have a question? You can raise the hand so that we can unmute.
So Balaji, Sharat here.
Yes, Sharat.
Usually people confuse between OKRs and KPIs, right? Can you help us understand in the layman language, like how?
Sure. Why not? See, Balaji need to reduce weight is a OKR, but then Balaji's current weight is 100 plus is a KPI. KPI is always a quantification of the OKR. Okay, for example, if I want to give a better example, right? When you are actually talking about maintaining a healthy lifestyle, that is a OKR. One of the KRA is ensure that your body mass index is within the permissible numbers. But then what is the range of the number? That is the KPI. KPI is mostly a quantification of the KRA associated behind it. Did I answer your question? That is the know the funda. Like once we create a goal, that goal will have multiple parameters, aspects or dimensions, right? Through which we can achieve that goal. Those parameters are called KRAs, but only with KRA. For example, right? If I'm actually saying application need to be application should perform well. Perform well means what? Like in terms of a non-functional requirement, I still need to have a SLA numbers, right? My response time, my throughput, my hits per second, my connections per second. Those are all the KPIs.
Thanks, Balaji. You made it very simple. thanks for that. Usually, sure. With respect to IT sector, you know, people are a little bit habituated to, you know, defining the OKRs, right?
Correct.
How about other domains like HR, finance, you know, these are newly coming into the space of agility, right?
Correct.
So usually I saw them struggling to define their OKRs. Can you share your experience in that area?
See, but I can share my experience typically in the IT sector only, you know, because I have not worked in a non-IT. But then one thing I can share is that, whenever we are trying to do an organizational level transformation or an enterprise level agility, now we have created an enterprise level transformation board across the multiple departments at a portfolio level. There we are now currently working on some of the improvements. See, for example, right, small improvements. Instead of doing an annual performance appraisal at an individual level, why don't we start doing a team-based quarterly performance appraisal? It is a simple example to implement agile mindset from a HR point of view, right? Similarly, your finance team started trying to do some kind of a rolling wave funding model. See, because whenever you try to do a dynamic budgeting at a portfolio level, be it using a desktop integration hub, or you have tools like Jellyfish, or you have tools like a target process, or you have, even if you take Jira Align, it actually supports a value stream management platform at a portfolio level. But then unless and until your backend finance systems also support a quarterly based rolling wave funding model, you cannot really do an end-to-end transformation. So across the different segments of the organization, we have created an enterprise level transformation board for some of our clients and start deep diving into those segments. But in terms of KRAs and KPIs, we are yet working on socializing it to the larger audience, because whenever we are introducing a change, we actually don't want to take a quantum leap. We want to take a small pockets of excellence over there. Okay, and for those who wanted to continuously learn, probably you can join my WhatsApp group also. Satish is also there as a part of this group. So he knows the value that we typically try to give to people on a daily basis through this particular WhatsApp group. Continuous learning happens over there. Okay, I think I'm pretty much done. And for any further queries, please do feel free to connect with me one-on-one. I have shared my WhatsApp number over there. Cheers.
Does anyone have any other questions? Okay. We are good, Balaji. Thank you so much for giving a valuable session on the OKRs and all. So as a token of appreciation from the SS Agile and Gurus, this is kind of an appreciation for coming to us and giving the presentation to our audiences. So we really appreciate your time and efforts has been taken into this. Thank you so much, Balaji.
Yeah, sure. And from my side also, I actually like to thank Sharath and Satish for continuously having these kind of sessions and their contribution to the Agile community at a larger forum, because I know how difficult it is, like that you need to balance your office work and then still contribute to the Agile community at a larger forum. I have been there and then done it, so I know that. So thanks a lot to all the other people, like the facilitators and all the planning committee people who actually made this particular summit a grand success or a value add back to the society, contribution back to the society. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Balaji.
Yeah, thanks. Cheers. Bye.